A very good morning. Welcome to The Big Stories. Friday, the 22nd day of July, 2016. And of course, in Uganda, we drink, we sleep, we talk, we live by politics. And it's only fair that as we close this week, we have a conversation around the political goings on. I mean, this is a story that has been playing out a bit subtly. I don't know what else has been dominating the political space in this country. But the idea of the Inter-Party Organization for Dialogue, also known as IPOD, has been somewhere lingering. It took center stage the other week, especially after that meeting by some sections of the opposition with President Yoweri Museveni at State House, which was conspicuously snubbed by the Forum for Democratic Change, never mind that FDC is a member of the IPOD. Fast forward, a lot of accusations, counter-accusations, pointing of fingers and all that has been taking place in those circles, to the point that now the Forum for Democratic Change is saying, you know what, we want out of the IPOD. And this morning we put to task the spokesperson of the Forum for Democratic Change, the Honorable Ibrahim Ssemujju Nganda. Why do you want to opt out? Why is FDC running roughshod over these other political parties? I thought that Agari Awamu, as they stay in Uganda, Yegamenye Gumba. Why is the FDC exercising this exaggerated sense of self-worth, as if to mean that they will be the only bully in the crowd in the opposition? Or maybe, to put it mildly, it's either the FDC's way or no way. Ssemujju obviously will have to elucidate on this point, and I'm sure he's got quite a number of answers lined up for this conversation this morning. We'll be right back. The Honorable Ssemujju Nganda, you're the spokesperson of the Forum for Democratic Change, the Inter-Party Organization for Dialogue, an organization of political parties represented in parliament that opted to sit, including the NRM, by the way, sit and have conversations around how the political dispensation in the country can be carried on so that we have a functioning democracy. What is happening to IPOD? Why are there punches and cracks in IPOD?
You see, the problem is that these things have happened by a coincidence at the same time. We were sent, because you see, IPOD has a summit, which is a platform for party presidents, yes, and chairmen. It also has a council of the secretary generals, and then it has
a general,
it has a secretariat, and it has another body where each party is represented by two people. I think at the start of, immediately after elections, we were sent a memorandum of understanding from the IPOD secretariat, which we needed to study as FDC, and if we accepted, we would then one by one sign that memorandum to reconstitute IPOD. We had issues with the IPOD. For the last so many years IPOD has been around, we are not satisfied that it was worth continuing as a party.
What were its pitfalls?
Part of the problem is that the NRM was not respecting it. So the reason we wanted to come together, we were borrowing the Ghanaian experience. When Rawlings was, okay, let me say, handing over power, there was an understanding that we can do politics in a civilized way. You don't have to kick at each other to make a point. So let's sit together and see things that can unite us and do them together, and then agree that these issues we will not accept. So the Netherlands Institute for Democracy set up a sort of IPOD in Ghana, and they really benefited from it. So we bought it and bought it from Uganda.
And got the same funders, donors.
So, but for what would have been the biggest achievement of IPOD was political and legal reforms. There were meetings there. They originated the bills, brought them to parliament. The NRM Secretary General then, Honorable Mambabazi, said these bills were done at a tea party. And he said, so government cannot own them. Yet, the understanding was that we will move these bills together, the opposition and NRM, through parliament. And what did they do?
Give me an example of one of those bills.
Well, we had a bill amending the Electoral Commission, so you can have, doesn't have necessarily to be equal representation, but at least you can have those who are competing represented. in the Electoral Commission at all the levels, wanted to amend the Parliamentary and Local Government and Presidential Elections Act to make provision for so many things that are missing.
Including funding for political parties?
No, the funding for political parties is under the Political Parties and Organizations Act. Mm-hmm. It has started, it can be improved. But there are also constitutional amendments and administrative, get the meter out of politics, the role of the RDC, and so on and so forth. As soon as they are brought to Parliament, I've told you what happened to them. Mm. So the IPOD did not achieve what we thought. So we said as a party, we'll need, first of all, to revise the memorandum itself, but also to get the NRM to commit themselves that this time around they will respect the gentleman's agreement.
Yeah.
So we were at that stage. I attended all the meetings. But we said, you see, you cannot stay outside when IPOD is being reconstituted. So let us send two people to represent us. And we appointed the Honorable Ruse Akol, MP, woman MP Amul, and Mr. Patrick Waguma, FDC Vice President for Western Uganda, to represent us, to be able to be part of the discussion, mm-hmm. reconstituting the IPOD.
Mm.
We received an invitation to go and attend a workshop. We said, do we attend? Do we not? I said, how do you run away from a workshop? We didn't know that a workshop was now going to take decisions. What we had next is that they are in Jinja, that they are in Entebbe.
And they first went to Mugolobi.
Yes, Mugolobi was a workshop.
To Jinja.
Even if
but
our Secretary General.
In those two meetings, your yes. Secretary General, the Honorable Nandala Mafabi, was mm. present.
Certainly, yes.
Not
so,
just even present, he was mm. the chairperson of the mm. plenary discussions.
Even if the Secretary General had participated, even if he had gone to Entebbe, it would still be a problem. Because you see, the difference between us and others, there are institutional decisions, but there are also key actors within the institution of the FDC that occasionally will make decisions, and the public will think these are institutional decisions.
But if your Secretary General has endorsed the decision, or has been a part of a decision,
it does not,
how dare you
FDC disown that? It does not matter. That's not how we make decisions. I've told the media every now and then, mm. they will find you, say, Muju, what is the position of FDC? I ask them, so when did the FDC seek to make a decision? Ask me what is my personal opinion.
But if you're the spokesperson of the FDC,
yes.
at any one time you speak something to do with the FDC, that must be considered.
I will
to be
always make a disclaimer. I'll tell you this is my personal opinion.
But then you're acting ultra-vires.
No, I am
you
not.
You cannot have your cake and eat.
Because
it
you see, you can't be an institution and each time you speak for that institution.
Let me tell you something.
Then that will be
if
a one-man institution.
If I'm going to discuss matters electricity, for
yes.
example,
mm-hmm.
if I'm going to discuss matters electricity generation, then what I say will certainly have to be the position of the Uganda Electricity Generation Company Limited, for which I work as the spokesperson.
So that's why you'll be very careful.
Exactly my
so,
point. So why can't you politicians be careful and speak exactly
no,
that?
No, we will make mistakes and we will accept that we've made a mistake here. So
yeah,
if our Secretary General had participated in deliberations, because our interaction with him, he said actually that he wanted the NRM to commit themselves, mm. and he said, let's go and meet Mr. Museveni, the chairman of NRM, mm-hmm. at Plot 10. Even has emails. But for
wait
me,
a
Semuju.
Semuju, stop the semantics.
For me,
what's the
yes.
difference between meeting you here,
yes.
I'm talking to you, Semuju,
yes.
meeting you at the Observer where you're a shareholder,
yes.
and meeting you at Parliament?
There is absolutely a big difference. If you met me at Parliament as a chief whip, I'll be transacting work of Parliament. If
Come
you met
on,
me at my home, mm. I'll be a father, so I can. You can't say that I visited the chief whip, but so
don't you have meetings at your house of a political nature that have a political bearing on your conduct in Parliament?
There cannot be meetings that take a decision on behalf of institutions at my home. Certainly, it cannot happen.
But well,
but the point, Simon, is that we took a decision as a party that let's first deal with the reconstitution of the IPOD.
Mm-hmm.
First, we will study the memorandum, make proposal to the secretariat,
mm.
together with everybody we can go and discuss those proposals. Once those proposals have been adopted and the memorandum signed,
mm.
then we can call ourselves IPOD and begin transacting business.
Right.
Before the memorandum is signed,
you can't be IPOD.
We can't be, because in our own
but
view,
my understanding is that the meeting with President Museveni was another consultation, number one, with the concern that all party heads and chairpersons seem to be available, except President Museveni. His mind wasn't being picked. That's number one. You seem to have an issue with that, especially when your party former presidential flag bearer, who at the time was in jail, complained that there was a group of opposition politicians that went to President Museveni and were discussing, among other things, a plea to release him. That's where the card started falling.
No, it didn't. That's See, I had been away for 10 days. When I returned, I was interviewed by the NTV. So they asked me about that meeting in State House Entebbe, and I told them, yes, people can go to Entebbe. It doesn't matter. But once Dr. Kizza Besigye is subjected to a legal court process, he shouldn't be part of the conversation. That point I made, his liberty, you cannot ransom his liberty. And I said that even before
you had it on a wrong context. Yes. Because the likes of Mathias Nsubuga, in subsequent interviews, have told us that they did not go to President Museveni and say, look, daddy, we have somebody incarcerated. Help us and get him out. They simply said, the NRM is susse in the harassment of opposition groups. For example, we just don't understand why one of the presidential candidates is languishing away in jail. That is a postcard image of political harassment. They didn't say forgive him.
You see, can Dr. Kizza Besigye is still a property of
and
the
FDC? And there's no way you can talk about political harassment in this country. So let's be honest with ourselves. You are a journalist, you know the prominence of subjects. You can't talk about political harassment in this country, and the name Dr. Kizza Besigye is not up on top of the list.
So that's why you must be very careful. If you are speaking about someone who's liberty, has been subjected to a legal process, by you pleading for his release, you make him look like he has accepted, I offended, now I am
drop
here to
the
be forgiven.
Word, please.
And it has happened. I'll
drop
tell
the
you,
word
I'll tell
plead,
you,
say, Mujo, you are using when, it erroneously. You are being, when, you're cherry picking.
When I think now is the Lieutenant General Tumukunde was in jail, Brigadier Kashaka went to visit him and he told him, you see, for me what I did, I went before the big man, asked for forgiveness, and I am out. My brother, can you do the same? We are only cautioning our colleagues, and we did it in good faith, that in this conversation with Mr. Museveni, because I have said many times, either me or my party, it is okay to go and meet the president. But what you discuss there is your business. So don't try to drag in everybody. Even if the FDC had gone, would that make the meeting better? If we must meet to discuss issues that are going to affect the country, you must lay a foundation. We don't want a Kasaka meeting of Naduri. That when we are in a Kasaka, we sat there, we have tea. This is what we agreed.
Show some respect for the minister without portfolio.
But he's the one who has said so.
The Honorable Nganda.
Yes.
Now, what we're having is a conversation of yesteryears. But let's look at the conversation of today.
Yes.
You are faced with a political situation where, obviously, the polarization of who is in power and who is out of power is something that, for the most part, paralyzes our ability to move forward as a country. Don't you believe that IPOD is still a relevant and necessary vehicle to have some political engagement that is premised on sanity? Why do you want out of
even yesterday, when we were discussing the police brutality, one of the resolutions of Parliament was that we need to revive, let me call it, a political committee chaired by the right Honourable Prime Minister, Dr. Ruhakana Rugunda. On that committee, you have the head of opposition, you have the two attorney generals in Parliament and other members. And we said we need to revive
the two what?
Two attorney generals. The shadow general. And the...
Don't bastardize those titles. You can't be two attorney generals. The attorney general and the shadow counterpart.
Yeah, so they are, so what was the difference? They are both created by the law. So the point is,
most obliged,
we can continue engaging. There are matters like yesterday. You must be amazed that all of us agreed that what police was doing was wrong, condemned by us and the NRM. There are issues on which we will agree.
Especially your remuneration, for example, as members of parliament.
And it does not matter. I mean, everywhere I've worked, I've been remunerated. I have never worked for free, at least for me. So when you employ me, you pay me, and I must discuss payment. The only difference is that you, Kasate, the discussion of your payment is never going to be a subject of the media. Mine will be, because I am a politician.
Without a doubt, because you're earning from the public funds, and many others do not.
Many people do, but they don't want. So the point is, we are not getting out of the iPod. We have only said, Let us reconstitute it properly.
Say that again.
Assign
you
our,
are not getting out of.
We have never said you are getting out.
Ah, so we
have only said, please, can we revise the memorandum? Because if you look at the memorandum that we signed, I think 5 years ago,
which had Conservative Party of
certainly
two members.
Yes, because at that time there were political parties in Parliament. We were six. They are out. But even now they are saying, please, we signed on the memorandum that funded this iPod. Please don't age us out. Even when you renew, you reconstitute, can we be members?
At least ex-official members.
At least as founders.
Yes.
That
or
discussion.
Ex-official, unable to make decisions.
I don't think they want to be ex-official. They want to be full members.
Oh, really?
That hasn't been decided.
Mm.
So once that has been decided, either that will leave them out or they will be party to a new iPod, you sign a memorandum, and then you see, the temptation by a politician is to be casual all the time. I am trying not to be casual, but in politics, it is normal to be casual.
But come on, you want to be you want to be serious in a place where nothing is serious. Everything is casually
we must.
Done.
I mean the requirement.
In this country, we do everything in a casual manner. Look at how you address, for example, well aware you are coming to a TV station to be watched by the nation.
On a Friday.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
I should even have been in a T-shirt.
No,
haven't you seen? You think politicians should be in the councils and in the parliament is a requirement.
No, but
so the point is, when I was, when
I don't know whether
when
I didn't tell you the dress code here, but please, even if I called you on a Sunday for Fourth Estate,
yes,
please come in something better than this. Don't be casual.
You should tell. I went to Rwanda. I have been to Rwanda many times. I visited the, I think what they call Rwanda Development Board. I didn't find any old person of advanced age. So I asked, were all the old people killed during the genocide? They said no. I said, but I don't see any elder working here. They told me the requirement of that organization is such a way that if you are an old man, either they will take you to hospital or you will die from there.
Yeah, what?
They even have an individual at the entrance whose duty is to make sure people beat deadline. The same things you find in newsrooms.
It's deadlines or
yes.
You are dead?
He will record every single document because that's where they process investment, they process permits and so on. So he will record every single document
that gets in there.
That gets in, and he will be following it through offices. So he will come to Simon and he will tell you that this particular application came to you at 6 a.m. You are supposed to deal with it in 4 hours. It is now 8 hours, so what is the problem? I kept asking here, and people thought I was very aggressive. Just imagine if you are giving a deadline to Kirunda Chivejinja, a deadline to Moses Hari, and by the government structure, the office of the Prime Minister, Dr. Ruhakana Rugunda, Moses Hari, Kirunda Chivejinja, in the past we had Kajura, they are the coordinators and supervisors of government businesses. Once you are casual, anyone can get in. You don't have, there are no deadlines to bid. Because here, just imagine that you have a duty to tell Chivejinja to beat a deadline.
And, but why not? We hold President Museveni, who is not very much younger than those people.
He can beat a deadline. Let me tell you, Museveni captured power when he was 42 years. It is not the same Museveni that you have now.
Well, so is the same Emuju. I don't see the same Emuju that I work with in the newsroom.
I have told
reporter.
People that I used to stand at Parliament a whole day. Now I can't. If I did, you will bring a stretcher.
One thing is for sure, I must commend you. One, at least, of all the politicians I host on this program,
yes. You
have beaten the record of coming in time.
No, I still do, and it's a problem. I told you that I have entered a field where people are casual, no keeping time. But when you told me I must be by 7:30...
Did you find a Herculean task, and not just even to cherry-pick the Kajuras and Kivejinjas of this world, even people, perhaps even younger than you, I have a character, the Honorable Gerald Karuhanga is unable to make it on time to this program simply because he is just simply unserious.
Yeah, because they work in an environment, no deadline, no targets, so you are a boss of yourself.
You are
accountable to nobody.
Let's go to iPod therefore.
Yes.
What is the streamlination, what's the kind of streamlining you want in iPod that your colleagues from the other political parties, UPC, DP, and others in Parliament, are failing to live up to? And what are the deadlines of constituting iPod? Because we don't have lifetime in Parliament.
We have written to iPod and made the proposals. First, let's go through, because they sent us that memorandum, we have it. Let's go through the memorandum. I think by close of next week, we'll have sent our proposals. Once those proposals have, and from others have been adopted, we will then sign a memorandum. But this time it will not be business as usual. We get into it to do some work. 2 years later, work is not done. I can assure you the FDC will completely now be out of IPOD. We have interacted. We have had tea in Tina. We have had workshops. But we are not.
But that tells us something about your orientation as the FDC.
Yes.
You really don't want civil engagements. When it is going to be an opportunity for civil engagement, you put in a lot of bukwakuri. So you try to make it difficult to operate. You just want to keep operating on the streets,
throwing
stones and demonstrating.
We don't want to give people false hope. We don't want to give people false hope that we are here cooking when actually you're cooking nothing. So they keep waiting for the meal to be served, and 2 days later you tell them, but there was no meal. We are just preparing.
Well, you are guilty of the same thing. Since 2001, you have been promising tsunamis, including yesterday's headline story in the red paper where your former presidential candidate says, I have the ability to cause a coup. Is that the kind of language you should be getting from people who want to engage in a civilized manner across the political
divide? Yesterday, before I was cut off in Parliament, I wanted to ask the NRM people whether Kizza Besigye, who was the Minister for Internal Affairs in charge of police, who was treating them when they were in the bush, is the same Kizza Besigye they are demonizing today. I have told people even now and then that for me.
So possibly the seeds he sowed when he was Minister of Internal Affairs.
That for me.
That now he bibas it.
That for me, I'll never go to the bush. I'll never pick an arm to go and move the government.
Same with you, are way past your time. There's no more
probably
bush for you to go to.
You can. Well, I remember Kanyankore went to, when he was a bit old. But he came back when he was one of the greatest fighters. One of the, because you see, in fighting, it's not only the picking, they are pranas. But the point is, Colonel Kizza Besigye, people demonize him. But it is not what people, especially those who don't want him, present him to be. He's a different person. But
he's a pacifist, nice guy.
Suddenly he's a nice guy, but extremely assertive. And that's why he was motivated to go and fight. I've told him, I cannot. In fact, I respect people who went to the world
to
fight.
You are a coward.
If I were around, like I would never have gone. But that's why I said, I am not going.
Yeah,
if I were around, I would never have gone. So people who went to fight, we need to respect them. Besigye went, I think, when he was about 24. Mugisha Muntu was 42. I think.
Why don't you give other examples 35. Like General Kale Kayihura? You also went. Tumukunde went.
Certainly, yes, all of them. So I respect all of them.
Oh, you do.
So when they continue battering, because to convince yourself, you finish your degree and the following day you're in the bush
fighting.
Taking
me around in circles. I simply put it to you.
Yes.
Are we going to continue with the usual politics of confrontation, or it's just about time we give institutions like IPOD the opportunity to create some civility in the way the politics is.
Nobody is interested in confronting either police or the military. We're only interested in sorting out issues.
Let's conclude this program, Semuju. Time is not on our side, but just one little question to you. The FDC, what's your game plan? I mean, clearly, you lost the election. I'm sure by now you should have capitulated. And so what's the game plan, FDC, to win the next election? Are you going to go out there and do what General Muntu has been preaching to you, albeit falling on deaf ears? Let's build party structures, recruit more members, try to perverse the message of FDC to the lowest level of society and move away from celebrity politicking of showing up on the streets and confronting with the police.
I have told everybody who has listened, who cared to listen, these issues are not issues of the FDC. They are issues that are affecting us as a country. Once you have this kind of politics of police on the road, the military, the NRM keeps sloganeering that we want to move Uganda to a middle
income,
yes,
lower middle income status.
Forget about that. The budget of police and the military, the budget of parliament, the budget of state house will keep growing once we make politics the main
lucrative,
exactly.
Livelihood.
So we need to have a discussion as a country on how we want to do politics. Even if the FDC has built structures from one border to another, they even buy them. You go, you've assembled the structure, by the next time you go, it has
been decimated.
Exactly. So we will need to do.
Have a conversation.
Ghanaians have done. They have changed the government like a foot. It doesn't have. It can be through IPOD, it can be through another platform. Because this is not about the FDC, it's about the country. The FDC can be disbanded.
So are you can speaking the FDC position or your personal position? I need to be clear, because you're speaking incredibly well this morning. You're not the militant you and dismissive.
I am not militant. I have told people I am assertive. And I have...
Is yours the position of the FDC or your personal position?
The position of the FDC is that we must do politics better in this country. Build institutions, respect them, allow them to function.
And the question is, who bails the cat? Who will do it first? Are you leading by example?
We will humble ourselves. If people want us to kneel before them, we will do it.
Oh, really?
Yes. As long as they can agree, let's sort out this. We've done so.
So President Museveni is going to invite you to State House. Will you, go?
You don't know how many meetings.
You have said several times that you'd never go to State House to have tea and eat cakes,
exactly.
Cupcakes.
That will not go. But if you want us to go and discuss the country, we will certainly go. That decision we've taken as a party.
You've taken the decision. So once there will be a dialogue between the FDC and the NRM. Should the NRM initiate it? Or are you also going to take the leap forward and initiate a conversation?
I have told you in the Parliament yesterday, we agreed a political committee where the head of opposition and the prime minister sit will continue having a discussion. The reason the Honorable Nana made that point in the iPod, that we need to get the NRM to commit themselves. It's not that we don't want to meet Mr. Museveni, but all the delegation that have gone here, they are telling me what they have achieved.
Nothing, perhaps.
When they go, the first thing, we don't have this, we don't have
they
this.
They go there
we don't
to beg. But as we conclude,
that we can't have.
Are you saying the FDC now, rather than previously, is open to a conversation around the future the future of the politics of Uganda?
We have been ready to discuss with everybody. We've met people. We have said once we lay the foundation for a honest discussion, honest dialogue, people will find us ready. But if it is meetings, take photographs to create an impression that we are talking when we are not, we will not be party to that. Serious dialogue, you'll find the FDC ready. You'll find us.
Semuju, I can't
call us tomorrow. You can call us today.
You say take one step forward, three steps backwards. I simply can't keep up the pace. But nonetheless, I must thank you for being a part of this morning programming and this conversation that we've had. Quite very illuminating. And obviously, you make a few pronouncements that indeed we hope that they are not your personal positions, but
they are institutional positions of the FDC. People will find us today, tomorrow. Once it is honest and serious discussion.
What determines whether it's honest and going to be the serious?
You write documents, you commit yourself, and people can look at that documents and they know that these fellows have gone to talk about the following. Because you don't, it's not a matter between FDC and NRM, it's a matter of this country.
Semu Jungana, the spokesperson of the Forum for Democratic Change and also member of parliament, here discussing with us the future of IPOD, FDC in IPOD, and of course the general conversation around the political stability of this country. Couldn't have had a better conversation on a Friday morning like this one. We continue with a huge and rich lineup of more quality programming. You can be a part of this conversation that Semuju and I have just concluded by taking to our social media platforms and putting forward your two pages on Twitter, Facebook. I'm even told there's something called Periscope and other places that you can find us where NTV is riding high for you to have your voice heard and make your say listened to. Good morning and have a wonderful weekend.